Books on Tape presents Dating is Murder by Harley Jane Kozak. Read by Bernadette Dunne. 1. Moth harmonica. That's what it sounded like, the guttural, heavy-accented syllables coming through my answering machine. A piece of haiku, until the woman rattled off an almost unintelligible series of digits that went on and on like a credit card number or the miles from Earth to Jupiter. I picked up the telephone. "Hi, this is Wollie," I said. "Who's this?"
"California? America, yeah?"
"Yes, California, America. Who's this?" "Yes, California, America. Who's this?"
"Encino?"
"No, not Encino. West Hollywood. 40 minutes away, traffic permitting. Who's this?"
Yeah, who is this?"
she asked. "That's what I'm asking," I said. "Who are you?"
"I am Moth Harmonica."
"Okay, I've heard worse. My own name, Wollstonecraft Shelley, is no picnic, especially for a girl. Or woman, as my friend Frederic insists I refer to myself." "Who are you trying to call, Moth?" I asked.
"Who are you?"
"No, who are..." I stopped. This could take a while, and I didn't have a while. "I think you have the wrong number," I said. And this brought forth a flurry of words that started with,
"Nine,"
and ended with,
"Annika."
"Annika," I said. "Wait, not Moth, your mother of Annika. You're Mrs. Gluck." There was an excited assent, lots of ya-yas, and another flurry of words. I closed my eyes and took a deep breath, trying to dispel a sudden bad feeling.
"Meine Annika," Mrs. Gluck said. "Called not tomorrow?" No, yesterday. And yesterday is Sunday. We call every week Sunday. So I leave message for host family but called me not back. I feel for Annika. Gefahr, danger. She is in big danger, as she call not Sunday."
I was nodding now. My friend Annika had called her mother from my apartment the previous week.
"She would freak out if I did not call each Sunday,"
Annika had said.
"But she will call me back, so it will not be on your bill."
Which is why Mrs. Gluck had my number. I said, "I'd really like to help you, but I have no idea where Annika is. She's tutoring me in math, and we were supposed to meet last night." I hesitated, not wanting to admit how I'd worried, thinking, Annika's never even late. "And she didn't show."
"Oh, Gott im Himmel, she is dead."
"No, I'm sure she's not dead. I'm sure she's..." The doorbell rang. "Can you hold on?" I zipped through the kitchen and living room and opened the door to Frederic, told her to give me 2 minutes, and zipped back to the kitchen. "Mrs. Gluck," I said, "I'm sure Annika will turn up, and if I hear from her first..."
Nein. For me, you must to find her. The host family call me not back, and the agency call me not back. No one in United States of America to..."
"But if she's really missing, I'm sure her host family will contact the police."
"Nein, no police, no trouble. You are friend, yeah? So you are to ask host family what is happened. For my daughter, mein kind."
Frederic, having followed me into the kitchen, pointed to her watch and mouthed the words, "Joey," and "double parked." I nodded and waved her off. "Okay," I said. "Do you have the host family's number? All I have is Annika's line with her machine." On which I'd already left 2 messages. Minutes later, I hung up and turned to Frederic, who was studying the contents of my refrigerator. It was early evening in late November, dark in my kitchen, but my friend was illuminated by the utility bulb. It was enough. She wore a tight, fringed jumpsuit in hot pink, low-cut, with a big plastic zipper running the length of it. She had the kind of va-va-va-boom body that could pull this off and the kind of temperament that would want to. Her hair, this week, was as blonde as mine, not unusual in Los Angeles, but whereas I had pale skin to go with it, Frederic was black, a less common combination.
"Where's your water?" she asked.
"In the sink."
"You don't have bottled water? What do you take on the road?"
"I don't take water on the road."
Sister, you have got to change your ways, she said, herding me into the living room. You have cosmetic responsibilities now. Who is this Annika person?
Annika, not Monica. Our Annika from the show. Her mother in Germany says she's disappeared. I grabbed my keys and backpack, alarmed at the word I just said.
And who does the mother think you are, the FBI?
She doesn't know who I am. She just happened to have my phone number. She can't reach the host family. Annika's an au pair. Did you know that?
Frederick handed me my jean jacket. What are you doing answering your own phone? We gotta get you thinking like a celebrity.
The word celebrity made me want to hide under the bed with a bag of Oreos, but Frederick had overstated it. I was only a celebrity to those rare people who watched a TV reality show called Biological Clock. Too few in number, according to the Nielsen ratings, to materially affect my life. I reminded myself of this as I followed Frederick out of the apartment, down the stairs, and out to the street. Rush hour noise from Santa Monica Boulevard accosted us. There was pedestrian traffic, too, as we walked down Larrabee, mostly male, as befits a neighborhood known as Boys Town. Frederick attracted her share of attention, her skin-tight jumpsuit an object of desire. West Hollywood is a bastion of gay and lesbian culture, which I, as a heterosexual female, found comforting in ways I didn't exactly understand. I caught myself really looking at people on the street, in cars, looking illogically, maybe, for someone considerably shorter than I, brown-haired, apple-cheeked, pretty, a girl in the last days of her teens, Annika.
There's Joey, Frederick said, waving to a green Mercedes stuck in slow traffic on Santa Monica, a mass of red hair visible in the driver's seat. What's she doing circling the block? I told her to stay put. Come on, let's catch up.
She grabbed my hand and we ran as fast as her 3-inch heels allowed, click, click, clicking our way to Joey. My friends were driving me to the night's location of Biological Clock. The reality show featured three women, d'un certain âge, as Joey put it, dating in rotation three men of various ages, so the TV audience could ultimately vote on which combination of genes should produce a child, with or without romantic involvement on the part of the chosen couple. I was one of the women. It hadn't been my idea. Here's how it happened. I'd been, okay, still was, recovering from a broken engagement to a guy named Doc. Doc had some issues that stood between him and marriage, namely, a wife, and the certainty of an ugly custody battle for their daughter Ruby once the wife became an ex-wife. The wife was keeping Ruby in Japan, so Doc had taken a job in Taiwan to be nearby. Production work on an American film called Mao the Movie, which threatened to go on as long as the Cultural Revolution. Custody would be a problem for 6 years until Ruby turned 18, and Doc felt I shouldn't wait for him. Joey and Frederick agreed. I felt otherwise, but nobody seemed to care about my opinions any more than Chairman Mao had cared about the opinions of the bourgeoisie. Joey's husband, meanwhile, had invested money in this reality show, Biological Clock, which had inspired Joey and Frederick to send my audition video to the casting director. I hadn't known I'd made an audition video. I'd thought I was being interviewed for Frederick's niece's sociology project. Apparently, though, me talking about my dating history was compelling stuff. Also, I was the right age and had attributes, big chest, long legs, and height, 6 feet of it, that made a nice visual contrast to the other two front-runner women contestants, and I'd thus beaten out several hundred hopefuls for the job. Not that I'd wanted the job. I'd turned it down flat once it was explained to me. I found the premise of the show cheesy, despite the disclaimer at the end of each episode that no couple would be required to have sex or bear children. As for fame, I'd have been happy to fork over my 15 minutes to someone else, the way senators give away their floor time in debates to fellow senators. But then Biological Clock had mentioned money. Despite the low budget, I'd be paid $500 a week for 2 nights' work, unusual for reality TV, and that wasn't all. the producers had invested in a number of other businesses, including a health maintenance organization, offering benefits to the winning contestants and their dependents, current and future. Some people say insurance isn't sexy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.